thanks folks for sticking around today. Really appreciate it. Hopefully, everybody's looking forward to learning about what's new in 3D scanning. This is sort of an industry technology overview, as well as more sort of, you know, what's new, but also sort of an overview of what's going on with the technology. My name is Chris Hindberg. I am one of the engineering managers at CanLogic. Just a quick note about CanLogic, just a quick spiel and we'll move on. CanLogic, if you can't tell by the name, we started in the CAN industry. We are, of course, a Siemens PLM provider, and we sort of got grandfathered into that through our initial start in the CAN business. So we've been doing this for a while, a couple of decades now, and I think that because we started, you know, here toward the end of the production process, it sort of gives us a unique knowledge and understanding of working our way back toward the design process, whether it's solid edge or NX or whatever your design medium is, and then we can work all our way, you know, all the way back through to the end of the production process and then even into quality control and inspection. So, you know, we think that we have a lot to offer to our customers. Clearly, the Siemens PLM piece, that's why we're here today. 3D scanning is why we're in this room today, and we also do 3D printing. So these are what we offer, but CanLogic doesn't make anything, right? We don't manufacture anything. That's mostly what you guys do. So what I like to say is really what CanLogic owns, what gives us our value is our people and our knowledge and our expertise and our ability to tie these three main offerings together. So CanLogic is really all this space in between here. And I like to say that we're the glue that ties all these three things together. And that's really what is sort of the value proposition for CanLogic. As for myself, I came to CanLogic from an IT background, actually. Before that, I had dabbled in custom home theaters and media distribution. And before that, I was in East Lansing rooting on the Spartan football team. It's a little tough this year, but still, go green. So, all right, now that I got that out of the way. So these are the three things we're really going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the available technology, what's out there, what's available as far as what can sort of seem like a never-ending alphabet soup of technology terms. And then we'll talk about the two probably biggest applications of that technology, being reverse engineering and quality control. Before we get into that, though, I do want to introduce you to this, if you're not familiar with it. Gartner is a well-respected sort of industry research firm, and they developed this thing called the Gartner Hype Cycle. And what we have here is your expectations of emerging technology here on the vertical axis. On the horizontal axis, you have the passage of time, and then it's divided into five phases, right? So you have the innovation trigger, which is basically the invention of the thing, all right? And then this is where the early adopters jump on the board, and they ride this thing all the way up to the peak of inflated expectations, and that's when things start to go down to the trough of disillusionment. And then once we get past this scary part of the ride, we start to cruise on the slope of enlightenment and finally the plateau of productivity. And basically what happens is once you end up here, your invention is off of the headlines, out of the news, and just becomes part of everyday life. So this is from last year. All right, so we have consumer 3D printing, which was poised right around this time last year to plummet into the trough of disillusionment, which it, I think, certainly did. If you had a hobbyist printer, you bought it with all these great expectations and then realized after you printed a couple small Yoda heads, I don't really know what to do with this thing anymore. enterprise 3D printing, because it's you know, a bit more mature, certainly more expensive, a bit more robust, had already sort of gone through all of that and was heading into actual real life usability. But obviously the one that I really want to concentrate on is 3D scanning. Never really got all the headlines that 3D printing did, but obviously you can see here there's actually more mature, more ready for prime time technology. So this was last year. So if you look at the chart this year and where 3D scanning is at, it's not even on the chart. So what happened? Did 3D scanning go the way of the dodo bird or what? No, actually it went the way of wireless communication and digital calipers and everything that we just take for granted. And so what has started as this really sort of Star Trek-y 3D scanning, no way, now it's just like, yeah, 3D scanning, it's of course, you know? So that's sort of what happens. Now, what I really want to try and drive home is that when that happens to a technology, it just becomes a fantastic new tool for all of us as designers and engineers to use. Throughout the course of humanity, when people make things with a certain tool and that tool gets better, the thing that we make gets better, right? So that's all that's really happened. We now have access to a phenomenal new tool called 3D scanning. So let's jump into the available technologies. So again, what's out there can sort of look like this. If you were to Google 3D scanning, this is sort of what you start getting. It really just comes down to two technologies, two major underlying technologies. The 3D scanner that you're using is either going to have a laser in it, or it's going to be a structured light scanner. There's one or two other exceptions, because there always are. Wide area scanning might be one, or CT scanning would be another one. But for the most part, 99.9% of what you see out there, these are going to be your two underlying technologies. Let's talk a little bit about structured light, what's going on, how it works. So this is a scanner that we have in our shop. It's made by Steinbeckler, who was recently acquired by Zeiss. Probably heard of those folks. What's happening is you have a digital projector and a digital camera mounted in that housing there. We have our part that we're scanning right here on this turntable. Turntable and the scanner are all driven by the software. You basically tell the turntable how many stops to make around 360 degrees, and the scanner captures that data in the system. How does it do that? Well, you see this strict pattern on here. What's happening is basically a ton of triangulation. So again, you've got the projector, you've got the camera, they are set at a known distance, at known angles to each other, and when those stripes are projected onto the part, it can register the deformation of those stripes, their curvature, their spacing, as the 3D points in software. So this is a look from inside the software where we can set exposure times for different surface colors. So if we're scanning white, we can get away with setting basically a faster shutter speed than you can if you're scanning like a dark gray or a black part. And then what happens is, as this part gets rotated around, you end up with overlapping data, right? So, let's see in this next shot, we have some overlapping data here, and up here you can see that we have a successful match between those two data sets. So this is really the power of what's happening with this particular system. You'll see some of them might need targeting dots, little stickers that you would put on there. This system is actually able to recognize the similar surfaces of the overlapping data and actually just lock those two shots right onto each other. And then basically the rinse and repeat just keeps going and going, spins around, captures more new data with more overlapping data, and continues to stitch this thing together until you end up with your full scan. So the The astute among you might notice that, of course, it's not fully complete, right? We didn't scan the bottom. There's some stuff on the inside that you're not going to get. And that's because this is a vision-based system. If you can't see it, we can't scan it. So what do? You just keep doing the same thing. If we were to remount this so that you can see the bottom, just take another rotation, and you still have a ton of overlapping data because you're going to be capturing a bunch of this side and a lot of the back, and it just stitches it all together automatically. So that's generally how the structured light scanning goes in our shop. When we travel, when we have really big things to scan, like a custom coupe, we can use the targets if we want to, right? So the system's very, very versatile, very flexible. And what's happening is, this is my compadre Dustin, rocking pre-series beard. You shoot the object that you're scanning, and it captures the targets along with the surface data, right? So now instead of looking at overlapping surface data to tie the two shots together, it's looking at those reference targets. And as long as you have at least three of those reference targets overlapping, it uses the center point of those to match the data sets together, right? So we can scan, you know, you can scan an entire bus if you wanted to, as long as you put targets on it. So it's really just a matter of, you know, understanding that this is sort of a relatively uniform, flat, gentle, sweeping surface that if we didn't have the targets would sort of slip, you know, with that overlapping data because there isn't really enough geometric uniqueness to lock it in. So very versatile system, very accurate system, and it's one that we probably use the most. So if we move on to laser, this is another system that was developed by Steinbeckler, now owned by Zeiss. So you'll see this under the Zeiss flag now. This is their T-scan. And the first thing you'll notice is that it's handheld. The second thing you'll notice is that you can scan really shiny things. You can scan black. You can scan all sorts of different surface colors and textures without much issue. That's the really big selling point for a laser-based system. And the reason for that is it's really not that much different from a structured light system. You still have a light source and a digital camera set at a known distance, known relationship to each other, and it's a bunch of triangulation. But because the laser is such a specific wavelength of light that the camera only has to look for that, you're able to scan all these different surfaces without really any surface preparation. That's pretty big. When you start getting into this stuff and really trying to knock out a lot of these projects, not having to worry about, am I going to be able to actually scan this surface, that can be a real time saver. The other nice thing is this system, what you don't see in the video is off screen, there's a tracker that's actually tracking this handheld unit. All those little silver stubs that are coming off of the scanner have infrared targets on them, and the tracker is tracking those infrared targets, and that's how it's positioning all the data in space. So there's the tracker right there. It's got three digital cameras in it, constantly looking at these infrared dots and tracking that scanner's position in space. So what you also get then is you can hard probe things. So it's the same infrared LEDs with a ruby stylus on there, and so you can hand probe, you know, certain features if you have a pretty prismatic part that you're trying to check or whatever. It's also nice for holes, because again, if we can't see it, we can't scan it. So if you're trying to scan down into a hole, you're only going to be able to get down as deep maybe as the diameter. Right, so we say the diameter, that's about how far down you can go. So if you need to probe deeper than that, you just put a longer stylus on there and you can get down in there. So those are the two main underlying technologies of 3D scanning equipment. It's pretty cool stuff, and it captures a ton of data, but frankly, data is pretty much useless to us human beings. we typically want information, which means we need to give that data some context. So the first thing we're going to do is some reverse engineering. So this is a beautifully restored 1934 Packard 12 coupe. We were able to be a small part in the restoration of not this exact car, but I'm sure it looks very similar to this and just as beautiful. And this is the small part that we got to do, the handle. Maybe not as sexy as getting you, like part of the body or something on the inside or whatever. But any good car designer or car enthusiast will tell you that that door handle is actually very important because it's the handshake of the vehicle. So we didn't actually do the whole handle though. It was really just the mount that held it to the door. But we were still excited to be a part. So typically when you're trying to restore something like a 1934 Packard 12 coupe, this is what you get. And this is what you've got to work with, and you need to make this shiny and beautiful and perfect. So typically what you do is you would fill this and sand it, and then cast it, and then make a pattern, and then make a new casting out of stainless or whatever, and then bolt it onto the car. And that's exactly what happened. Except when you cast something, it goes from a hot liquid metal to a cold solid metal. When anything, except the water, goes from liquid to solid, you get shrinkage. Which isn't really that big of a deal, it's just a door handle. Nobody's gonna really notice, 5-6% shrinkage from a door handle. But the problem is these mounting holes don't line up anymore. So we took the scan data and fired up GeoMagic Design X, which is the industry-leading reverse engineering software right now. It's owned by 3D Systems, and it is a fantastic piece of software. So, first thing we did, the scan data, right? So, we've got the front and the back. You can see some missing data. That's this spot here, this brown is actually the back side of this top face. But the nice thing about reverse engineering is that we don't really need all the data, we just need enough of the data to accurately describe a particular feature, right? We don't need the entire hole, we just need most of the hole to be able to accurately determine the diameter and the depth and that sort of thing. So we scan, we bring in the scan data, and then we do a freeform surface wrap. So these are NURBS surfaces. We fill in these holes, because we're going to recreate those parametrically in a minute, and wrap this. So now these are CAD faces. This is math data, but it's completely freeform. If you try to do any synchronous modeling with this, good luck. But for this particular application, it worked wonderfully. It's a very accurate representation of what the scan data was. So that's why we used that. Then everybody's favorite sketches, right? The foundation of any good CAD package. So what we do, this is the power really of GeoMagic Design X, because basically what we're doing is you can take like a thickened section of this particular thing, sort of like a live section, and then once you have this, you can use this light cyan curve to actually make your sketch curves. And then once we have those, we can extrude it, we're going to extrude this and then merge it into this body. And then here we've got another sketch that we're revolving just halfway around that we're going to subtract out of this portion. And then we've got this sketch here that we're going to revolve as a surface and use that to cut away some other stuff. And eventually, 3D print it. And then what you do is now you've got it 3D printed. Well, actually, before that, what we did is we actually increased it, right, by 6%. So that when it gets cast, it shrinks down to the size it needs to be for the holes to line back up. So then we print it. And of course, we print it in a casting plastic. So it can be sent directly to the foundry. They can use this as a casting pattern. and end up with your part. So that's reverse engineering. Like I said, it's really interesting that we actually need so much data to get this information. So what you're seeing is sort of a shift, I think, in the industry, because we actually used to see a ton of inspection quality control jobs. We're actually seeing a lot of reverse engineering stuff. I spend a lot of my time in DesignX these days. But information is king, so I guess it sort of makes sense. But inspection, most engineers don't really like to talk about. Quality control always ends up getting the short end of the stick when it comes to time, right? You're at the end of the production process, and it's rush, rush, rush. We need to inspect some quality into these parts and get them shipped out the door. So, obviously, the intention with finding out what's wrong with your part is finding out what's wrong as early as possible, because it's a lot cheaper and a lot easier to fix the problem when you find out early. So, of course, inspection started off, you know, in earnest with technology, with the CMM. CMM's been around for a while. It's incredibly accurate. And that's about it. Really accurate. I'm not going to try and tell you that 3D scanning should replace all the CMMs of the world, because there are some things that a CMM can do that a 3D scanner just can't do, accuracy being one of them. Now, when I mean accuracy, you know, some of the 3D scanners out there, you're talking about plus or minus 7 microns for their uncertainty. That's pretty good. But there are CMMs out there that can do quite a bit better than that. So, one of the main drawbacks of CMMs is you have to bring the part to the CMM. Most 3D scanning systems are going to be pretty portable, so you can take the system, the measurement system, to the part. And of course, as your part gets bigger, because your entire part, if you're checking the entire part, has to fit in the entire volume of the CMM. So as your parts get bigger, your CMMs have to get bigger, and of course, the price tag gets bigger as well. And then, you have the CMM report. Who loves CMM? Anybody? Me neither. Going back to data, the difference between data and information. Before 3D scanning, this was the best information we could get. This information really isn't that much different than the raw data that the system is capturing. It's really difficult for humans to parse this out and make sense of it. Right, you're gonna get this, and then you're gonna start making charts. You're gonna highlight stuff, you're gonna put them in nice little columns, and you're gonna do all of that so that you can actually have something graphical to look at and try and understand what's going on. Me, I'd rather have that. This is the type of inspection report that you get from a 3D scanner, right? This looks like the production prints. That means something to us as humans. We are visual people. And when we see green, awesome. When we see yellow, might be a problem. So let's see how we get here. All right, so this is the complementary software to Geomagic Design X. This is Geomagic Verify, which has just been updated to, it's called now Geomagic Control X. And this is their inspection package. Of course, the first thing we do is bring in the CAD. The CAD is perfect, and that's what we are all striving to replicate in the real world. Once we have the CAD in, we can bring in the scan data. That's the purple data that you see there. Of course, the CAD is in the coordinate system that it was designed in. The scan data is going to be in the coordinate system that it was scanned in. Typically, most scanners, the 000 is going to be in the camera lens or in the center of the body of the scanner or whatever. So you're not going to have everything lined up right out of the gate. So we do an initial alignment so that we can start doing some feature matching. So behind the scenes, the software is looking at the planes and cylinders and surfaces and drawing correspondence between the CAD data and the scan data. Once it's able to recognize that this surface of the CAD is the same as the purple surface of the scan, we did our datum alignment that you just saw, and then we can do the 3D comparison. 3D comparison, your spectrum is over here, so all of your warm colors means the scan data is sitting above the CAD, all your cool colors, the scan data sitting below the surface of the CAD. We can change all of this, we can change our tolerance zone here to whatever we want it to be. And of course, that's not the end of the story with inspection. With scanning software, we can do full-blown GD&T callouts referencing, you know, with our data reference frames, dimensioning, and as you saw, basically replicate the views that are on the prints, which, again, as engineers, our job is to communicate, right? So the best way that we can communicate, I think, an inspection report is to put it right up against the production print and match it up and say, okay, this is what it's supposed to be, this is what it is. You know, you don't really need to do much explaining for that. So you see we've labeled the datums there. It's as easy as clicking on the CAD surfaces to start pulling off dimensions. This is something that is unique to Geomagic. Verify and Control X now. It's what they call it, it's CAD aware inspection software. So most inspection software, when you bring in your CAD, it's actually, unbeknownst to you potentially, actually converting that CAD into an STL. Now it's going to retain these edge breaks and it'll still sort of know that this is a cylinder and sort of know that this is a plane, but you actually have to create those reference features before you can take any measurements. This software completely skips that whole step, keeps the CAD as native CAD, and uses the CAD surfaces, which are perfect to begin with, as the reference surfaces. So if you're pulling off a positional callout, and all these tolerances within the specific dimensions can be adjusted to obviously whatever is called out on the prints. You can see that it's highlighting the data that's being used for that particular dimension. The nice thing is, I think we might see it in the report. When you get the report, for this one dimension, you know, you might have used 3,000 points. Pull that one, call it. If you ask the CMM operator to pull 3,000 points for a hole, I don't think he'd be very, or she would be very happy. There's a surface profile combo. So again, what people expect as the deliverable for your inspection process is the inspection report. And again, I will gladly put this up against a Excel spreadsheet CMM report any day of the week and twice on Sunday. Get all your statistics for your datum alignment. Screenshots of the deviation map with the statistics and sigma histogram that goes along with that. And then there's our GD&T layout. So there you can see the number of points for each dimension. And that, the formatting of that report, that's straight out of the box. That wasn't doctored up for this presentation. That's just you hit the report, hit create new, and it just grabs everything and does it for you. So it's incredibly powerful. And again, you know, stuff that's just really not possible without 3D scanning. So it's all well and good, but of course, if we're talking about measurement, I would be remiss not to mention these guys, right? Everybody's favorite. These are mine. I love them. And the reason that you see these on every single engineer's desk is because they're relatively cheap, they're reliable, and they're readily available. You can get these on Amazon for $150. You can get them for $20. I've got a couple pairs at home of the cheap ones. Cheap, but they work. Now, the reason I bring this up is because I really don't think that it's that crazy of an idea to see desktop 3D scanners right next to your pair of calipers in the near future. Now, of course, that sounds great. I would love that. I'm not sure our budget can really handle that, because 3D scanners are still relatively expensive. This guy right here is going to run you maybe $12,000. All right, for a desktop structured light system, and that doesn't even come with like a certificate or way to calibrate it or anything. The data is phenomenal. If you wanted to do just like a quick first article inspection for like first hit off of a stamping press or injection mold or something like that, it'll totally work. For reverse engineering, it's phenomenal. But the reason that I bring that up is because you can already do it for free. Right, you can download an app on your iPhone or Android phone, or the one guy that has a Windows phone, you can get it too. And again, it's not very good, but it's free, and you can carry it around in your pocket, and that's still pretty cool. You can step up and basically get handheld Xbox Kinect, and those are like $150. You can get even a smaller one that you can strap right onto your iPad and start scanning stuff. And those actually aren't that bad, and they capture color and texture. All right, so you want to step it up even more, you can actually get a little turntable. I think this guy's like $1,500. It's a Next Engine. It's a laser-based system, and it's actually a really capable little system. We had one for a little while, just to sort of play around with. There's the other one I mentioned, that's from 3D Systems. It's called the Geomagic Capture. Again, maybe a little spendy right now, but really capable system. And then the one we saw earlier, the handheld laser system, you're talking pretty big bucks. But, of course, we all know that what happens is, once things move through this hype cycle and end up out here on the plateau of productivity and out of all the headlines and just become a part of everyday life, they get better and they get cheaper. You gotta remember, at some point in time, those digital calipers were out here, right? So it's really just a matter of time. 3D scanning is an absolutely phenomenal tool, and I think it's really going to allow us as engineers and designers to really, you know, start amping up our designs. We're going to be able to iterate more quickly and create some really fantastic things. So that's it. That's all I have. So questions? Are there any questions? Are there any users of 3D scanning? Yeah, sort of.
No, I have used it in
the past. Okay, right on. Well, so there you go. A little primer on 3D scanner. How many people wish they had a 3D scanner? Cool. All right. Well, thanks for sticking around. Appreciate it.